Our all speakers have to see on this topic. So again, I hand over the mic to Koton Ghosh and I ask him to start our seminar. Thank you. Thank you, Dr.
Thank you, madam, for your valuable speech. Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam. Yes, madam. Now I request ITC coordinator, madam, Professor Suripta Goswami, assistant professor in of our college, to deliver the welcome address. Madam, please. Suripta, madam. Suripta, madam.
Good afternoon. Yes.
Suripta, madam, can you hear me?
Yes. Can you hear me? Yes, I can hear you.
Hello, Suripta, madam.
Yes, I can hear you.
Yes, Suripta, madam. Please, madam.
I can
please,
hear
madam,
you.
Start your welcome address.
Okay, okay.
Okay, madam.
Okay.
Start your welcome address, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, ma'am. Good afternoon to all of you, respected principal, madam, Dr. Anunna Ghosh, distinguished resource persons, Dr. Shobhushachi Ghosh from IIT Bhilai, Dr. Kanon Dutta from Presidency University, Dr. Samir Chowdhury from Queen Mary University of London. The convener of this webinar, Mr. Koton Ghosh, my esteemed colleague from different institutions and from my own college, research scholars, my dear students, and other learned friends. I am highly obliged that I have got the opportunity to welcome you all in this international webinar on behalf of the organizing committee of the Balarampur College. The topic of this webinar is a journey from quark to universe. Generally, we all know that universe is the collection of all things that exist in space. It includes planets, stars, galaxies, dust, clouds, light, and even time. The universe contains billions of galaxies, each containing millions or billions of stars. The space between galaxies is largely empty. So there are many unfold mysteries present within it. Today, our eminent resource persons will open up various aspects of the universe to us. I am sure that we will be highly enriched with knowledge after the completion of this webinar. I welcome you all once again and hope you all will have a great time ahead. Thank you all.
Thank you, Suripta madam. Now we are going to start the technical session. Before going into this session, I would like to request all the participants again to mute your audio and video. Please cooperate with us. You may also ask questions by typing in the chat box. If you limit time, your questions will be moderated and a few of your questions will be passed to the speaker for discussion. Kajol, am I audible? Kajol, am I audible? Hello? Okay. Thank you. In this session, the first speaker is Dr. Shobhushachi Ghosh, Assistant Professor in Physics, Indian Institute of Technology, Bhilai. His broad area of research is high energy physics, phenomenology, and nuclear theory. Dr. Ghosh has obtained his PhD degree from the Variable Energy Cyclotron Center, Kolkata. He has several postdoctoral research experience in different institutes of India and also abroad in Brazil. He had received the most prestigious fellowship, D.S. Kothari, and FAPESP fellowship for PDF program in India and Brazil. He had taught in different institutes with various capacities before joining as an assistant professor in IIT Bhilai on May 2018. In the last 5 years, he has published more than 20 research papers in reputed international journals, William Conference Proceeding Paper, along with his collaborators all over the world. Apart from his regular academic activities, he has been guiding the PhD students actively.
this early stage of universe through the experiments. So the directions of the experiments roughly along this. So with the facility setups of today's, we can actually probe these states of matter, and where actually only this quark gluon plasma things probably I can say, but not the other things. But actually it is happening something like that. Today's whatever we are seeing, that human beings, living beings, planet, land, earth, or stars, anything. So all they are the material bodies, or even the light also, they are in a single point, some point of time. And there was explosions, which is called the Big Bang. And after the explosions, everything is distributed. Okay, and the present scenario we get. So these things I'm telling is just a single line, but actually this is not a very simple things. So because we see that our today's universe is not so distributed type of, so there is too many in equilibrium kind of things also. So if you want to jump this sea of informations, you can click on this Wikipedia link, and you will get the first you will get the first informations from where you can probe more and more on different stages also. So they have a different Wikipedia link, and you can just do the research on the internet. You can just know that what is the present scenario of those things. So actually these things you probably already know, but this will be required. So this number system, we are acquainted with that, but we should not forget. If we forget, then probably we will take the help of this slide. The thing is that the 10 to the power 3 is the thousands, and if it is the power is 6, then it is 1 million. If power is 9, then it is billion. If power is 12, then we call it trillion. So these are we should be acquainted, so that if we say something is million, something is billion, so we at least we get some feelings, at least we get some feelings that this is very large, very very large. So thousand with respect to thousands, million is thousands times larger, something like that. So this thing actually we required when you really understand our time scale, universe time scale. So from Big Bang to today's universe, if you want to know the rough time scale, so the time scale is roughly 13.4 billion years. So this billions means is 10 to the power 9. Okay, so this is actually very huge. And how much it huge, so that is why I invest probably two or three slides to get the understanding that actually our universe age is huge, and whatever that diversity we see, this is just recent times. This is in very ancient time, nothing was there. So probably the three slide, it is a little bit of non-physics slide, but still let us invest so that we can get a flavor that where we are. So actually the human civilizations, what we know that, but this times is not very a long time. It is just 5 million years before this human civilizations roughly started. So, and also it is not just today's civilized human. So it is just from that human evolution's pictures happening. And the million years is 10 to the power 6. So with respect to 10 to the power 9, this 10 to the power 6 is basically as a error word. So you can safely ignore. So you see this very interesting thing is the human beings. And this evolution's time is just nothing for the whole universe time scale. So let me take the other time scale so that we get some better feelings. So other time scale is the sun evolution. So this is the typical sun evolutions pictures. So let's say here sun is born. It is roughly 8 × 10⁻⁹, means 8 billion years after the Big Bang. And this positions is our present day's universe age, which is 13.4 billion years. So this is the present scenario of sun. And actually sun also have a his own fate. So these things is comes to the astrophysics things. So probably our later speakers will tell about a little bit of, so I'm not going to that. So if you see it, the sun time scale, so the sun is now is in very young stage. So there will be some time sun will be gone. Okay, so I'm not going to tell all those things because very sad things. I don't want to tell those things. So now this time scale, if you want to zoom more, so probably this, you see that's before 10⁻⁹, I have not put anything. So I am just ignoring these things. So this 10⁻⁹ to this part actually very interesting. And only from this point, sun is born. And from this point, so whatever the human civilization's time scale, it is just a point. I cannot also zoom in and I cannot show this million years time scale. So we should understand. So whatever the interesting fact we are getting, okay, we are happy with that. But there are a big time scale where actually our universe take time to build all the entire things. And actually the before 10⁻⁹ things, the physics things is there, but after 10⁻⁹, this zone actually you can see that the biology things is there. And so this evolutions, probably people either find this interesting movie, The Ice Age, if you don't seen it yet, so you should see. So this is related with that missing link creatures during this evolutions. Okay, so this is the last slide I am investing for this time scale. So I'm sorry for that, just too much slide I'm investing for this, just to know the time scale. So this is very interesting, which is called the cosmic calendar. So you can see the details in this Wikipedia link. So actually this billion years I'm telling, so that is 10⁻⁹ years. So I'm just writing this 10⁻⁹, but actually it is huge. So for us, it is very hard to visualize, but if we convert this billion years to a year, okay. So 1 year things is, we can sense, okay, because we know the 1 year is a 12 month. I know I have a feelings in January, February, March, okay, in October times, I got the puja vacations, December time is too cold. So I have a feelings of different months. So now if I convert that billion years of our universe age into this 1 year, then actually from this January, the beginning date, the t equal to zero, the Big Bang is started. And I'm not going to tell all those things because all those things actually is a matter of the physics. I will come from the next slide. So the January, February, March to up to August, there is some designing is happening, but this design probably for common people is not so interesting, because interesting things comes when human beings, something, some hope from human beings or living beings comes, then probably we feel a little bit of interest. So actually at September, this solar system is created if you convert this billion years things into a year. So in September, so you see that's a long time it takes just to design the whole universe. And where is the possibilities of life we till now know? It is Earth. There may be somewhere, but till there is no data. So in September, solar system is created. In October, the oxygen is created through photosynthesis from the planet, from the plants, or maybe at the time plants is not created, I don't know. So in November, there is a possibilities of creations of sales. And actually, whatever the living creatures is happening, it is just the month of December. Okay, and now if you zoom this month of December, 1, 2, 3, to 31st December, then actually from 1, 2, 3, 4, to 8, so these times, the living structures are created. So you heard about the dinosaurs. So actually, today we don't see any dinosaurs, so that is why we don't believe, but actually, they are the beginning creatures of the earth. And in parallel, there was mammals, some birds is created in these times, and flowers. And at the almost end, the 30 December, that there was a disaster. And through these disasters, this all the big creatures, the dinosaurs types creatures, is destroyed completely. There are few small creatures, the mammals, so this is the scientific claim from the evolution's pictures. They have some evidence also. So actually, this evidence things I'm not going to tell. So I will just take the informations first. And the evidence things, you can just, if you click on the Wikipedia links on different aspects, you will probe on it, then you can get it. So at the 31st December, so only the interesting thing happening. So if you see the whole year, nothing is happening. 30 December, there was a disaster, all dinosaurs gone. And from the 31st December, some interesting things come. So the mammals now goes through the evolutions. And now the human beings are created. And almost, so it is just like 8 p.m. from 9 p.m. to 10:30 p.m. And it is about the before lunch times, people have started to just roaming away from different land to other land. And actually at the last minute of the year, in the 31st December, so the civilization is started. Okay, so it is the 62nd things this cosmic calendar is expanded. And so the most probably interesting thing will, if we compare, that we know that that Jesus was born in before 2020 years ago. So that is why that our calendars, English calendars, is based on his burning. So the Christ born around this. So it is roughly 5 to 4 seconds. Okay. So this is the way we can understand. So whatever the creatures is our civilizations we are seeing, we are happy, we see that it is too much evolve is going on. So this is just the recent time phenomena, but there is a huge durations where actually universe take time to design. And as I told, each stage have a different physics. So actually this time scale is not a linear, it is very non-linear. There are sometimes it is very non-monotonic or dramatic things happening, probably in fractions of second. And there is some big years, actually we don't get any non-monotonic phenomena. It's just a monotonic or boring phenomena. But collecting of all those actually is ultimately the universe is created. So now from the next slide, let me come to the physics point of view. So this is the rough temperature scale with the y-axis, and this is the time scale. Okay, so I guess now we already habituated with this time scale. So it is in seconds, that is our 10 to the power 18. Otherwise, if it is year, then it will come to 10 to the power 9 years. So you know the years to second conversations. So now you see, so actually, in this scale, this if you break the second is 10 to the power minus, so this time scale is 10 to the power minus 12 second. So this is very, very teeny time scale. So in this teeny time scale, actually whatever the baby universe is created after the Big Bang, So my aim is to just to understand this. So I'm not going to the research topics of those things, but I will try to define this matter through these lectures. So this actually is a different that our universe goes through just these evolutions with the time, and its temperatures is actually cool downs, and today's temperature of entire universe, so roughly I'm telling, so actually it is tell through that actually there is a cosmic microwave background radiations which is the actually take this evidence. So this is our universe temperatures is 2.75 in as a whole. So roughly I'm drawing this it just to mean the universe have evolutions and temperatures also have evolutions, and I want to understand this that baby universe state. So now from our daily life we have some realization, if you increase the temperatures, that matter whatever we see, for example we see the ice below the 0 degree centigrade, so in Kelvin scale it is 273 Kelvin, so if you increase the temperature then it melts to the water, if you increase more it goes to the vapor states or gas state, if you increase more so then there is another state which is called the plasma state. So actually if you analyze what is going on, so in physics perspective, so you know they have actually the solid or liquid, they have some building blocks, so either molecules or atoms, whatever you understand, but they have some fundamental building blocks they are made, and these building blocks are close to each other in solid state. When you give the heat to these systems, so they have a bonding and that can be break, and from the liquid to gas states they can be changed, and for different substance actually you need different temperatures. So actually, so if you want to probe the matters, if you want to know the actually what is the fundamental building blocks, so we realize there is one of the way is just give a heat, and now giving heat, heat is basically the energy, but giving heat you have a limitations, because for ordinary substance from solid to liquid to gas, some substance our Bunsen burner heat is sufficient, for some substance you need more heat, so for that probably you need some electric power to give the heat. Okay, and actually you have to invent different technology to give this heat so that we get that this kind of system, the solid to liquid to gas, it means they are spreading them, they are breaking to each other the bonding, and we'll get some more spreading kind of systems. Let us take one example, that the hydrogen molecules. So if we give the sufficient heat to the hydrogen molecule, they can just break the and they lose the identity of molecules, and they can convert it to the hydrogen atoms. So the hydrogen lamp is the example of that, and you know that huge heat is required to achieve this state, and actually this from the spectrum we can know that the sample is basically the hydrogens. For different samples they have a different spectrums. Now if you are not happy with this temperature, if you need more temperatures, then what are the way? So if your electric power is not sufficient to, because you want more and more heat, is 10 to the power 12 degree Kelvin, so it is trillion degree Kelvin if you want, so then the possibilities is that, so that the nucleus or the protons what we deal, so if I accelerate them and if I collide with each other, then there is a possibility to invest this huge energy to the nucleus. Now there is a problem. The problem is that suppose whatever that matter you heard, that is the many body systems, and the energy they are equally distributed from our statistical mechanical concept or thermodynamical concept, there is a equipartition's law. So it necessary that they have a equilibrium distributions. It means energy have to distribute it equally, and roughly the average energy of each particle or candidate is basically equivalent to the temperatures. So these things actually people also suspect whether it's really happening or not. But there is some evidence also that through this nucleus, if you go to the huge energy, so these are the accelerator facilities. So these are a large group of experimental people are associated with that. And since I am a theoretician, so I don't get this opportunity to go there. So only happy with these photos for the Facebook. So this is the way the two nucleus, if I collide, and then probably we can achieve these temperatures, this 10 to the power 12 degree Kelvin. So if this temperature, if we able to create it, then actually, we don't expect this neither molecule level, neither atom level. Even in the nucleus levels also, they also have some fundamental building block, and we can achieve that part. So the idea is that, so this is the upstairs photos is basically the natural phenomena from the Big Bang to our present and is universe. So they goes to different stages, and this arrow is showing that particular stages when our universe was in the quark gluon plasma state. And this the downstairs pictures is basically in the laboratory's pictures. So it is not exact picture, so it is imaginations. So in laboratory, what is happening? So if you collide two nucleus, then these states, this baby universe state, probably they can able to create it. And so whatever they created, so they can also through some detectors, they call the detector setup, so they can measure. So detector is basically, so if you want to see these things, so everything we cannot see by our own eye, so through the delicate experimental device we can detect them. So that is called the detectors. So these two links probably you can go through. So if you are more interested about that, what is QGP, what is quark gluon plasma, and how it is related with that early universe stage. So next I will invest some slide just to know why this high energy is required and what is happening in this microscopic world. So this is the typical electromagnetic spectrum. So this is also very interesting things that whatever the visible light we can able to see, this is not everything. There are other possible lights also which our eyes cannot sense, but they exist with the different frequency and different wavelength. And from these to this, actually the from long wavelength to small wavelength, it is going on, and you can equivalently understand. So this much wavelength is too big, just like a football ground. This is just like a cricket ball. Okay, and this way, so this visible range here, so is probably micro orders, the bacteria, DNA. So you can get the equivalent equivalent samples through which you can relate these things. And actually, if you decrease the wavelength, and decrease wavelength means increase frequency, and actually according to quantum mechanics the frequency and energy are related. And if you go to the smaller wavelength or larger frequency, then its energy is so large, so there that Einstein equal to mc square, actually which we think it is just like a fantasy, energy cannot create some material stuff. But actually it can create if we go to this level of energy, and this level of rays actually have a special name, the gamma rays. So actually if you go to the high energy level, so there you are too many interesting physics things actually happening. And this microscopic world is really very odd with respect to our daily life understanding. So let us go one by one to this low energy to high energy, so that probably we will get some rough pictures. So let us start from our daily life things. Probably in your home, you have a tube light. This tube light is, we can assume it is just like an electron gun. Means electron is accelerating from cathode to anode. Okay, and during his journey, electron is facing the gas molecules inside the tube light. So these gas molecules, they have atomic structures. And during this journey, the electron probably face the valence level electron. So there, according to the atomic structure, there are many electrons. So probably you know these things. So there is outermost shell electron, which we call the valence electron. So if your electron gun, the electrons coming from the electron gun in the tube light, so we know this voltage is 220 voltage. So for the with the help of the 220 volt electron, actually you can disturb the inside the gas of your tube light. You can disturb the valence level electron, and by this disturbance, so actually there is some phenomena, quantum mechanical phenomena. I am not going to that, but during this disturbance, actually you will get the rays, and this rays is belongs to the visible range. So if you probe more, if you go to the more energy, the kilo electron volt, then you can disturb the inner cell electron, and actually you will get some different rays, the X-ray. And you know probably the story of the X-ray discovered by Röntgen. So these things actually, when the particle physicist era came, at that time scientists tried to understand in different aspects. So actually this rays is coming from these atoms. So whether this rays is inside the atoms or where, what is going on? So they have some other way to understanding. So actually that protons and electrons, they are feeling attracting to each other. So these feelings actually, or this force or whatever the interactions you say, so they have some different realizations of interactions. They tell, so suppose this is your electron and this is your protons, they tell the interactions or force is happening just like a postman giving the message from electron to proton. And they give the information, so you have to attract. So this fellow actually inside the atoms was in the virtual state. And if you disturb these systems, these virtual things may comes as a real thing. So that is why we are getting the visible range. So different energies is also possible by this postman. So now this postman now come into the real picture. That is why we see the visible range light or see the X-ray, right? It is a matter of disturbance if you give it. Now if you disturb more so that I can enter the nucleus. So if I enter the nucleus, then we know the nucleus is just made of neutron and proton. There is nothing else. But with the help of the accelerator facilities, if you disturb this nucleus, then some strange particle will come. So those particle we never know. So we don't know. We are not aware whether nucleus is made of this particle. And this is not just one particle. So it is a huge, just like a particle juice. They are coming. If you increase the energy greater than mega electron volt, you will get it. Okay. And later people have realized actually they have some building blocks which is called quark. And actually the neutron, proton, whatever we understand, this is just one of the patterns of the quark. But there may be other patterns also, and they are in the virtual state. So if you disturb this nucleus, all those patterns can come as a real state. Just like that, these lights or photons, they are in the virtual state. But if you disturb, you will get in the real state, that visible range or X-ray. So this way that actually that all particles and collectively called the hadrons. So proton and neutron is one of the hadrons. So there are many particles. They are made of this quark. So just like, just remember the chemistry. So chemistry, we know these are the fundamental elements. And you just, if you do the permutations and combinations of the, all those elements, you can create the compound elements, any elements of the universe. Similarly, that we are habituated only the protons and neutron, but there are many possible hadrons can be created. And they are basically the permutations and combinations of these quarks. And actually, till now, we have our standard knowledge is that there is 6 quarks, and they have a different mass. So whatever the hadrons you will get, so they are basically the combinations of these 6 quarks. And these combinations also have some particular patterns. So there is a 2 quark antiquark. One of the possibilities is a quark antiquark combinations. Another possibility is 3 quark combinations. And they have a different name. So that is the great details things. So these things actually just like a dictionary in particle physics people, they are documented, which is called the particle physics booklet. So this is just like a dictionary of the particle physics. They don't have to remember all those things, but they are documented. Just like the chemistry people, the periodic table is there, that dictionary. Let me come to the end. So just this slide I want to tell. So there, this is the existing facilities, accelerator facilities. So if you go to the our country wise, so in our country we cannot able to achieve the large energy facilities. So few mega electron volt facilities they can achieve. But actually, if you remember my earlier slide, so actually if you want to know this ghost particle as a real, you need greater than 140 MeV. So with our Indian facilities, we may not able to create that things, but there is some other low energy experiments people can do with those facilities. But if you see the international status of those energies, so it is now they achieved 200 GeV, and then comes to the large hadron extension, it is 5.5 tera electron volt. So it is huge with respect to mega electron volt. And there actually they claim that with the nucleus-nucleus collisions, if you do this much of energy, then we can able to create that baby universe, which is made of the fundamental building block, quarks and gluons. So I'm not telling the whole lectures, probably I have not tell what is quark and what is gluon, but I have tried to how they came from the experimental things and from theoretical understanding. So let me summarize what we learned. So it is very quick journey. So but we need some, at least some sentence which we should take as a granted. So just like that, we try to realize there is some fundamental building block of the universe, and quark is that building block of the universe. So how that we come from atoms to nucleus to protons to quarks. So just like electron is a fundamental particle, similarly, so far our up-to-date knowledge, so from experimental or theoretical side, so these are similar to the electrons, the fundamental building block. And actually you see this quark is creating the whole things, the nucleus. So if you see the mass of the atoms, the whole mass is nucleus. So this quark is responsible for that. So if you try to understand this quark or these states is really very challenging to understand the whole universe things. And another lines we have to remember that after Big Bang, universe was in that state. And this experimental facilities, the Large Hadron Collider, CERN accelerator, they can produce artificially this baby universe. So from the signatures, experimental signature, they're claiming that. So these are the things, and they actually detect. So I'm not going to all those things, but they demand that whatever the natural way it is created, they are artificially have created, and they are trying to understand the properties of that things. of that baby universe says. So people focus centered on this baby universe. There are many experimental and theoretical groups in different corner of the world are engaged in their research, but unfortunately I have not touched anything of those. So just a last slide, I want to tell who are not belongs to exactly these subjects or want or interested to jump on it. So just caution about the language actually. So you know that mathematics is our only language to understand the universe, and some caution about the twist concepts also. So if you see the history of the evolutions of understanding of physics, so there are too many twisting concept came. So that is why actually the whole physics, probably here there are too many students. So that is why that graduations physics, then master degree physics, these are created. And after the master degree physics, probably you now will be on the stage. Now you can just play with those your existing knowledge, existing mathematics, and you can try to understand that whatever the challenge in the research and that. And I guess that you don't have to be too much cautious, just jump on the mathematics and concept and probably will achieve. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh, for your hello. Am I audible?
Hello? Yes, yes, Tatan.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh, for your nice presentation. Now I request the participant to ask questions by typing in the chat box. Due to limited time, we will forward a few of your questions to the resource person. Please write your question in the chat box. So far, we have the questions from Dr. Porimol Ghosh, Department of Physics, BB College. He has asked you, what is the life expectancy of our universe?
What is the life?
Expectancy.
Okay. Can you tell in other language or no?
What? Is there life exist in universe? Maybe something like that. If I don't
okay.
If you go to chat box, it is written over there. What is the life expectancy of the universe?
No. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, I just want to know. Mm-hmm. You are telling that there is a baby universe.
Mm-hmm.
So baby says that they get it to some age. That's why I'm asking you that what is the age, the expected age of the universe? I am just asking that.
Okay. So actually today's age of the universe is 13.4 billion years, probably that you know. So that baby universe, what I am telling, so if you say the Big Bang is t equal to zero, then after microsecond, this quark gluon plasma, this state actually created. So I'm just putting the name, this state as a baby universe, but it's up to you to define. So probably the nucleosynthesis after that happening, so that things also you can, it is in very early stage. So actually the first 2 or 3 minutes, there are too many dramatic things happening. And each stages are actually the matter of research interest of different community. So actually I have just pointed this quark gluon plasma because this is my field. So that things I pointed. So this is also is very small time it survives. So it is not, and it changed to the other state. So quark gluon plasma, then hadronic state, then it comes to the some few seconds later, so the first atoms.
What is the lifetime of our universe? I just want to know. All have some lifetime, lifetime of the universe, expected lifetime. Okay, this is my question.
You are telling about
expected
the future
lifetime of the universe.
Okay, so you are telling about the futures, means after 13.4.
Yes.
Okay, so that things I don't want to comment, but so that things probably if you see this Wikipedia, so they have a far futures. There are too many speculations. And now it's up to you which things you will believe or not. So there are too many speculations for that.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, sir. Welcome, sir. Thank you, sir. Dr. Ghosh, can we move on to another question?
Yes, yes.
So another question, Dr. Nityananda Das from JK College Purulia. He has asked, in experiment, when temperature of 10 to the power 12 Kelvin is created, what type of material is used as the experimental chamber which can be tolerate this temperature?
Yes, yes. So that is actually very interesting question. So that is actually come when we also enter to the PhD, that things also come to our mind also. So actually, so this is the phenomena in the Fermi scale happening. So this time scale as well as space scale, both are is too small. So probably now you can be, try to believe whether it's created or not, that is different topics. Now, if you assume this is created, then this thing is happening only in the nuclear level, this temperature. And actually, after creating these things, it tried to expand. And this expansion is also happening. So let's say in the beginning, the medium what is created, this temperature, it is, let's say, 2 Fermi orders. And it is expanding. And then after 10 Fermi, what happens? Their medium property lose. And whatever their building blocks, ultimately at that time, the building blocks will be hadrons. And that hadrons actually individually come to the detector. So whatever the detector setup or experimental setup you create, in your detector, this temperature will not reach. So they just come to the, just like you have a water and your water molecule actually come to your detectors. But let's say your water have a huge temperature, but that your detector cannot fail. Your experimental facility cannot fail. So that is the way this thing is happening.
Okay, I think Dr. Das has got his answer. Sir, are you audio? Okay. Due to limited time, we should stop the question answer session here. So, thank you, Dr. Ghosh, once again for his outstanding. Hello.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hello.
So, thank you, Dr. Ghosh, again for his outstanding presentation. Through your wonderful lecture, we have enlightened that how LHC at CERN is dedicated to probe the baby universe. And also familiar with our low energy experiment facilities that are available in India. We have discussed, you have discussed a lot of things in a lucid way, starting from elementary physics, and we are really enriched through your lecture. It is clear that quark and gluon are fundamental building block of our universe. Thank you once again for your wonderful talk. I hope that you will always be available with us as and when we organize such type of seminar. Thank you. Hello, Kajol, am I audible? Hello? Okay. So before going into the second lecture, let us introduce our speaker, Dr. Kanan Kumar Dutta, Assessor UGC in the Department of Physics, Presidency University. His broad area of research includes astrophysics and cosmology, cosmic dawn, cosmic reionization, H121 centimeter radiation, post-reionization epoch, etc. Dr. Dutta has obtained his PhD degree from Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. He has several postdoctoral research experience in different institutes of India and also abroad in Stockholm University, Sweden. Dr. Dutta has obtained many awards, including Oscar Kellin Postdoctoral Fellowship 2009 by Oscar Kellin Center, Stockholm, Sweden, Fast Track Fellowship for Young Scientists from DST India in 2012, and he is Assistant Professor position under Faculty Research Scheme since 2013. Dr. Dutta has published more than 28 research papers in highly reputed international journals, including PRL, 6 books, chapter, and 4 conference proceeding papers. Apart from his regular academic activities, he has been guiding the PhD students actively. Above all the academic achievement, it is a great privilege and also very much excitement for me to introduce my very close dada, Kananda, from my locality before the audience. Dr. Kanan Kumar Dutta, to deliver his lecture, the title of his talk is Seeing Our Universe Through Radio Telescope. Dr. Dutta, please, sir.
So can you hear me?
Yes.
And can you see my slides?
Yes, sir. It is visible.
Okay, so let me make it full screen. So is it okay now?
It is okay.
Okay. So first I would like to thank Honorable Principal Madam for organizing such a beautiful program and on a very nice topic, that is on universe. And I also would like to thank organizer Totun and other members of IQAC for the opportunity to present some of my work that I have been working on. Today, as you see, today my topic is how we can observe our universe using radio telescope. All know about what is telescope. Today I'm going to focus on radio telescope. So let me proceed. So you see, there are three pictures that I have put up. So is it okay if I speak in Bengali, or you want me to speak in English? What language you prefer? I understand there are many Bengali participants. So if you want, I can speak in Bengali, or if you want, I can also speak in English. So let me know. Or I can also speak in bilingual mode.
Okay, it is better to speak bilingual, I think so.
Okay. So you see three pictures in this slide. And you know what is this? This is our galaxy. So our galaxy is Milky Way. So the left picture, মানে বাঁ দিকের যে পিকচারটা এটা দেখতে পাচ্ছেন একটা নাইট এই নাইট স্কাই এবং মাঝখানে দেখতে পাচ্ছেন এখানে অসংখ্য স্টার এর মধ্যে একটা রোডের মতো এটা স্ট্রাকচার তৈরি করেছে এবং এই জন্য এটাকে আমরা বলি মিল্কি ওয়ে মিল্কি কথাটার মানে মিল্ক এটা দুধের মতো সাদা ওয়ে রাস্তা অ্যাক্রস দ্য স্কাই এই ধরনের আকাশ আমরা অনেকেই দেখেছি পার্টিকুলারলি পুরুলিয়া বা বীরভূম বাঁকুড়ার মতো রিমোট জায়গায় এবং যেখানে লাইট পলিউশনটা অনেক কম এই সমস্ত জায়গায় থেকে এইরকম আকাশ খুব পরিষ্কার দেখা যায় কলকাতা থেকে ডিফিকাল্ট এরকম দেখা এবং এই যে স্টার এগুলো দেখছি এটা হচ্ছে অ্যাকচুয়ালি এই অসংখ্য স্টার এর মধ্যে কিছু গ্যালাক্সিও আছে ডেমিনেটলি এবং স্টারের মধ্যে কিছু আয়োনাইজ গ্যাস মলিকুলার গ্যাস এগুলোও আছে এবং এই সমস্ত হচ্ছে আমাদের মিল্কি ওয়ে আমাদের যে গ্যালাক্সি সে গ্যালাক্সির পার্ট মানে দিজ স্টারস আর অ্যাকচুয়ালি মেকিং আওয়ার গ্যালাক্সি আওয়ার ওন গ্যালাক্সি মিল্কি ওয়ে বাংলায় আমরা অনেক সময় বলি আকাশগঙ্গা আর ডান দিকে যে ছবি দুটো দেখতে পাচ্ছ এই ডান দিকের ওপরে যে ছবিটা টপ রাইট ইমেজ ইট ইজ অ্যাকচুয়ালি দ্য সেম গ্যালাক্সি আওয়ার মিল্কি ওয়ে গ্যালাক্সি বাট ইট ইজ শোন ডিফারেন্টলি সো ইফ ইউ স্ট্রেচ আওয়ার গ্যালাক্সি অ্যালং ওয়ান অ্যাক্সিস ইট উইল লুক লাইক দিস আর নিচের যে নিচে যেটা দেখতে পাচ্ছি এটা হচ্ছে আমাদের গ্যালাক্সির ছবি কিন্তু এটা কোনো টেলিস্কোপ দিয়ে এটা অবজার্ভ করা নয় এটা হচ্ছে একটা আর্টিস্টিক ইমপ্রেশন আর্টিস্টিক মানে আমাদের গ্যালাক্সি তো আমরা গ্যালাক্সির মধ্যেই আছি তাই আমাদের গ্যালাক্সির মধ্যে থেকে আমরা গ্যালাক্সি ছবি তুলতে পারবো না ইট ইজ ডিফিকাল্ট উই ক্যানট টেক পিকচার্স অফ আর গ্যালাক্সি স্টেইং ইনসাইড দ্য গ্যালাক্সি ইট ইজ ডিফিকাল্ট মানে সেলফি গ্যালাক্সি সেলফি তোলা সম্ভব নয় আমরা ঠিক আছে এটা একটা আর্টিস্টিক ইমেজ এবং আমরা দেখতে পাচ্ছি যে গ্যালাক্সির মাঝখানে একটা ইয়েলো বাল্জ টাইপের তার কারণটা হচ্ছে এই মাঝখানে ম্যাক্সিমাম নাম্বার অফ স্টার্স গুলো থাকে এবং তারপরে স্পাইরাল আর্মস এর মতো যেগুলো দেখতে পাচ্ছি এগুলোকে স্পাইরাল আর্ম বলা হয় এবং স্পাইরাল আর্ম গুলো মেইনলি মেড অফ স্টার্স আর স্পাইরাল আর্ম এর মধ্যেখানে যে ডার্ক একটুখানি ডার্ক মতো যে রিজিয়ন সেইগুলো হচ্ছে মানে মোস্টলি ফিল্ড উইথ লো নাম্বার ডেন্সিটি অফ স্টার্স অ্যান্ড গ্যাস লাইক দ্যাট So this is how our galaxy looks like. এখন আমরা যে গ্যালাক্সি দেখছি এই যে ছবিটা দেখছি এই ছবিটা কিন্তু আমরা দেখছি অপটিক্যাল লাইট দিয়ে মানে আমাদের লাইট বলতে আমরা যেটা বুঝি ভিজিবল লাইট এই ভিজিবল লাইট হচ্ছে লাল মানে রেড লাইট রেড কালার থেকে আপ টু ভায়োলেট তাই তো সাত সাত রং সব মানে এই সাতটা রং আমরা দেখতে পাই রেডের নিচে এবং ভায়োলেটের থেকে বেশি ফ্রিকোয়েন্সি লাইট আমরা দেখতে পারি না আমাদের আই সেটাই সেন্সিটিভ নয় তো আমরা যে সমস্ত ছবিগুলো দেখছি এই ছবিগুলো হচ্ছে যে গ্যালাক্সি থেকে যে লাইট শুধুমাত্র রেড এবং ভায়োলেটের মধ্যে থাকে সেই লাইটগুলো দিয়ে দেখছি এখন প্রশ্ন আছে যে তাহলে কি গ্যালাক্সিটা শুধুমাত্র রেড আর ভায়োলেটের মধ্যে এমিট করে, অন্য কোনো ফ্রিকোয়েন্সিতে এমিট করে না? কারণ আমরা জানি লাইট বা ইলেকট্রোম্যাগনেটিক স্পেকট্রাম সেটা একদম শুরু হচ্ছে রেডিও ওয়েভলেন্থ থেকে আপ টু গামা রে, রেডিও, মাইক্রোওয়েভ, ইনফ্রারেড, তারপরে ভিজিবলটা মাঝে, এবং তারপরে তোমার ভিজিবলের পরে আছে আল্ট্রাভায়োলেট, এক্স রে, গামা রে। তো গ্যালাক্সি কি তাহলে রেডিওতে বা গামা রেতে ইমিট করে না? অফকোর্স করে। তাই আমি যে এখন যে স্লাইডটা দেখাচ্ছি সেটা হচ্ছে একটা ফুল ইলেকট্রোম্যাগনেটিক স্পেকট্রাম, এবং এটা শুরু হচ্ছে রেডিও ওয়েভলেন্থ, বাঁ দিকের ওয়েভলেন্থটা অনেক লঙ্গার ওয়েভলেন্থের রেডিও, 1 মিটার 2 মিটার ওয়েভলেন্থের লাইটকে বলি আমরা রেডিও। আর একদম ডান দিকে যে স্মল ওয়েভলেন্থ বা হাই ফ্রিকোয়েন্সি সেটা হচ্ছে এক্স রে, গামা রে। এখন আমরা যদি আমাদের আমাদের গ্যালাক্সিটাকে যদি এই ভিজিবল লাইটে দেখি তাহলে মাঝখানে যে ভিজিবল বলে যে ব্যান্ডটুকু আছে এইটুকুতে দেখি তাহলে গ্যালাক্সি উইল লুক লাইক দিস। কিন্তু আমাদের যদি এমন কোনো টেলিস্কোপ থাকতো বা আমাদের চোখ যদি এমন সেন্সিটিভ হতো যে সেটা আমরা রেডিও লাইটও ডিটেক্ট করতে পারি তাহলে গ্যালাক্সি দেখতে কেমন হতো? ডক্টর ডক্টর
ইয়েস দেয়ার আর সাম পার্টিসিপেন্টস ফ্রম আউটসাইড বেঙ্গল, সো ক্যান ইউ স্পিক ইন ইংলিশ প্লিজ?
ওকে ওকে okay, so now you see this whole electromagnetic spectrum. So if I observe our galaxy in different wavelengths, like in radio wavelength or millimeter wavelength or infrared wavelength or ultraviolet or an X-ray, how our galaxy will look like? So I have shown some pictures. So the one just below the visible light, this is the galaxy I have shown you before. But if I observe a galaxy using radio wavelength, it will look something like the one that is shown in the left, extreme left. And then millimeter wavelength, you see the millimeter galaxy, and then infrared galaxy, and then visible galaxy, and ultraviolet galaxy, and X-ray, and then there will be another galaxy corresponding to gamma ray. But you see, the same galaxy, it looks differently if you observe with different wavelength. So now you can ask the question, so what is the true galaxy? How does it look like?
Whether Dr. it's... Doctor. Hello, Dr. Doctor. And the yes. Problem is here, your slide are not visible. Please share your slide again, please, sir.
Slide is not visible, okay?
Not visible.
Yeah, but you can hear me, right?
Okay. Hey, yeah. I can hear you.
Okay, stop. Okay, let me stop. Hello?
Okay. Hello, I am listening.
Let me share the screen again.
Okay.
Is it okay now?
Is it okay? Okay. Now it is okay.
Right. So now you see, if I observe our galaxy in different wavelengths, the galaxy look like different. So if I want to actually know the complete picture of a galaxy, we need to observe galaxy using different wavelengths, right? For example, using radio, millimeter, infrared, like that. So if I go to the next slide, so what does that mean actually? So let's say if I observe in visible wavelength, or if I observe in radio wavelength, what do I actually see? So if I observe in optical, so we use the optical telescope more often, right? Now it is available commercially. You can buy from Amazon the optical telescope, but not the radio telescope. And if I observe in optical telescope, you see mostly the stars inside the galaxy. But if I want to observe the gaseous material like hydrogen gas, helium gas, it is convenient to use radio telescope, because, for example, hydrogen gas emits in radio, and I will talk about that in a little bit more details. So if you want to observe the gaseous part, you have to observe in radio wavelength. If you want to observe the molecular parts, so galaxy also has some molecules in it, like carbon monoxide, And if you want to observe that, you have to observe with microwave telescopes and infrared telescopes. And if you want to observe very hot plasmas inside the galaxies, you have to observe with X-ray telescopes and also in gamma ray telescopes. So if you want to observe everything inside the galaxy, just one telescope is not enough. You have to observe that using different telescopes. So I can give you an analogy. Let's say if I want to, if you have a picture of a human being, so that means you are observing the outer part of that human being using the if you just take a mobile photo. But if you want to observe the bones inside that human being, you cannot take photo of bones using mobile phone. You have to take the X-ray image, right? So something like that. So if you we need different telescopes. If I move on to the next topic, so I think I have convinced you that in order to get a full picture of an astrophysical object like stars, galaxies, or the universe as a whole, one telescope is not enough. We have to observe in different using different telescopes. And one of the most promising telescope, a useful telescope, other than the optical telescope, is radio telescopes. So, and I will talk about the radio telescope. Today my talk is about actually radio telescopes. And we may not have heard about it much, but this is one of the extremely important branches of astronomy. And it has made immense contribution to the development of astrophysics and astronomy. And I will give you a brief account of that. So this slide you see on the right, you see some structures. And this is basically a telescope. This is the first telescope. Of course, it doesn't look like a telescope. So the telescope you know, or I know, basically is completely different from that what you see here. So this is radio telescope, and it was built in 1932 by Carl Jansky, who is known as father of radio astronomy. So he was basically a radio engineer, and he was actually asked to measure the radio signal that is originated in Earth. So he was actually doing some experiments to radio communication, transatlantic radio communication, and he was asked to measure the signal that is coming from in the radio band. So he made this telescope for that purpose, and he started observing it. So he got some results, but interestingly, so he could understand all of them, but apart from the terrestrial radio signal that is coming from let's say from high tension electric line or some switch, faulty switches, apart from those signal, he also got a signal like this that you see in the picture. So you see some kind of periodic signal. So that periodic signal is very mysterious, because he cannot explain that signal. Any man-made sources cannot emit such kind of signal. So he actually studied more. He rotated the antenna, and he did his experiment for several months. But he still is observing this kind of signal, which is very mysterious, because no one knew what it is about. So he investigated more and more, and then he finally concluded that this is the signal that is coming from, not from our Earth, but it is coming from outside Earth. So initially he thought it is coming from our sun, but later he concluded that no, it is not coming from our sun. Actually, it is coming from our center of galaxy. And so that is the starting of the radio astronomy. So this is the first time one actually able to detect a signal coming from the outer space, from the galaxy. And that's how the radio astronomy started. And so it is 1932, it is not even 100 years. So radio astronomy is very recent topic. compared to the optical astronomy, because optical telescope was discovered more than 400 years ago by Galileo. So you see, radio astronomy is relatively new branch of radio astronomy. But even if it is new, it has made immense contributions. So later, Grote Rebert, another scientist, radio astronomer, he actually built a telescope that you can see on the left. And that is this particular, this telescope looks like a traditional telescope. You see now, so I don't know if you have seen it or not. Earlier, we used to have a disc kind of antenna, dish antenna. And dish antenna is something like this. So it used to detect TV signal. So the same kind of technology used here. And Grote Rebert built his very close to his house. And then he observed the sky. And then he found two new sources of radio sources, that is called Cygnus A and Cassiopeia A. So these are the two strong radio sources. And he also confirmed the results observed by Karl Jansky. Karl Jansky, the result that I have discussed with you before. So it was not a faulty result. So he has independently confirmed it. And you remember the time, 1937, that was the time when the Second World War actually was started. And the environment was very hostile around the world.
Dr. Bhatto? Yeah. Hello?
Yes.
Please slide your slide is not visible. Can you please share your slide again? Some of the participants are saying that.
Okay, how can I do? Okay, let me.
Now it is visible.
You can see my slide, or you can see the Google Chrome, Google Meet page. Do you see my slide, or you see the Google page?
Not slide. Now, sir, everyone is saying that it is visible.
Okay, let's see. So I have changed my slide. Can you see it? Quasar and radio galaxy?
Yeah, visible.
Can you see the quasar and radio galaxy slide?
Yeah, it is visible.
Okay, so that's how, I just started a topic. So that time it was Second World War, and our world was, it has a hostile environment, and nobody could think of doing research in that time. It was very difficult time. So the research kind of stopped, but then again, when the World War stopped, people again started doing research, particularly on radio astronomy, because during the World War, there are some technological development for radar technology, which is similar kind of technology as radio astronomy. Okay, so that research start going on, and then the first important discovery made by radio telescope is quasar and or radio galaxy, and I show you two pictures of radio galaxies. So radio galaxies looks like this. Now the color you see, it is of course visible color, and as I said, radio means you cannot see those color by your eye. So these colors are false colors. So it is just given to give you some idea about how radio galaxy looks like. So radio galaxy is a galaxy that emits enormous amount of signal in the radio wavelength. And it is, these are the, it looks a long tail, you see. And this is happening because there is a very powerful black hole. And I guess if all of you are very fascinated about black holes, so there is a black hole at the center, and that along the two sides of the black hole, very high energetic particles like electron, proton emits, and those very high energetic particles interact with the galactic environment, and they emit a synchrotron emission. I don't know if you have heard about synchrotron or read about synchrotron emission, but those synchrotron emissions and then those synchrotron emission I see. So this is the picture that you see is basically the emission from synchrotron radiation. But we cannot see the black hole because, of course, this is not visible. But it is happening because there is a black hole. So there is an indirect proof that there is a black hole. And this is first, this was discovered first time by radio telescope. This is one of the important contribution of radio telescope. So now I have changed my slide. So can you see it? Hydrogen, neutral hydrogen atoms. Please say yes if you have, if you are able to see it. Can you see my slide? 21 centimeter from neutral hydrogen atoms. Hello. No.
Hello, sir. We can't see your presentation, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can you see? So the network is actually very poor. I'm sorry for that. It's raining outside and the poor network is very poor. I don't know what to do. Can you see now?
Yes.
Yes, sir. We can see.
Sir, actually, we can see through YouTube app, but we can't see it in the Google Meet app.
Oh, I see. Resume presentation.
I request the participant not to share any slide.
Now we can see.
You are presenting.
Please don't share any slide. I request participant not to share any slide, please.
No, no, this is my.
Be with
this,
us.
This is my. No, 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 this is my slide, I think. So can you see it?
Yes, sir. Now we can see.
Okay. Thank you. So another important contribution from radio telescope is that discovery of 21 centimeter signal. So 21 centimeter signal is nothing but a signal that is coming from neutral hydrogen atoms. You know that our universe is, you know, there are more than 105 basic elements, right? However, only hydrogen and helium. It consists, the universe is consists of 99% of the baryonic matter is actually hydrogen and helium. Although there are total 105 elements, hydrogen and helium, actually they are most abundant. And it fills up 99% of the visible matter, right? And hydrogen, neutral hydrogen particularly, it emits 21 centimeter emission. That's a hyperfine transition. So if we observe this particular radiation, we can actually see the hydrogen. And the picture that you see on the left bottom, there are two galaxies. One that is taken by optical telescope, and it is written there. And the one, the same galaxy taken by radio telescope, and you see those two galaxies are different because optical telescope we see only stars, but if we observe using radio telescope we see a very much bigger galaxies because it take images of the hydrogen gas, and hydrogen gas is spread over much longer size. So now we see if there is no radio telescope, we would imagine that the galaxy is very tiny, but it is actually not. It is actually very big. So that was another important discovery from radio telescope. And these pulsars and stars, radio emission from stars and pulsars. Can you see the slide?
Yes.
Okay. So this radio emission. Radio emission from pulsar and stars. Pulsar. Basically a very compact object, and it is neutron star. So it is made of neutrons only. So Sobhasachi actually told you about neutron, protons and early universe. So these neutron stars actually made of only neutrons. There is no proton, electron, and it is very compact, very heavy. So if you take one matchbox size of neutron star material, the weight of that material will be equal to 1 cube kilometer, 1 cube kilometer of Earth surface. Right. So 1 cube minus 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer a cube. The weight of that cube from Earth surface will be equal to a very small, tiny amount of neutron star material. So it is so heavy. And not only that, it has a huge magnetic field, and I'm not going to talk about that. And since it is also very heavy and compact, the gravitational field is also very strong. And this neutron star is rotating, and it is emitting towards the pole. You see these two beam, white shaded beam. So this is the emission, radio emission, and it is rotating. And when it is rotating towards us, so it is rotating continuously. When it is coming towards us, we see the pulsar. And when it is not coming towards us, we cannot see it. So we see a pulse radiation. Although it is emitting continuously, but we see only when it is coming towards us. So that's why it is called pulsar. So we observe a pulse after some interval because it is rotating. It's called pulsar. And this pulsar actually is a very important object. And it was first discovered by radio telescope in 1967 by these two persons, Barnell and Hewis. And Hewis was given Nobel Prize for this discovery in 1974. It was so important. next important discovery by radio telescope is dark matter. We all know about dark matter, right? Dark matter, dark energy. So using radio telescope that we have important results regarding the dark matter. So Vera Rubin in 1970, she actually measured the rotation of the stars around the galaxies. And then the rotational velocity is so huge. The velocity of the stars at which they are rotating, they are so huge that the normal matter cannot explain that rotation. So there was a proposal that there must be some material which is invisible. Not only the galaxy is made of not only the visible matter, but it also made of invisible matter, and it is called dark matter. And it was later calculated that dark matter is actually at least five times more than the visible matter. So it is so actually the universe actually it has more dark matter than the visible matter. And then this is the image of our galaxy because and we see the galaxy is rotating. I am not going to discuss this. Okay. So these are all actually discoveries made by radio telescope. Now let us discuss what is actually radio telescope, how it is built, and what are the important radio telescopes that we have in our Earth, in this world. So when you build a radio telescope, there are mainly two things that are kept in mind. One is the resolution and the sensitivity. The resolution, you know that resolution or resolving power of an instrument is a property that if one instrument has high resolving power, that means it will be able to separate out two closely spaced objects like the one that is shown in the right image, but the same two objects will appear as a single image if the resolution is poor. So better the resolution, you can see the more fine structures or you can separate out closely spaced objects. And another thing is sensitivity. Sensitivity is basically the ability to observe faint objects. Let's say one telescope has high sensitivity, it can observe very faint objects, right? Let's say you have an electric bulb, and if you keep it at different distances from you, after some distance, you won't be able to see it with your naked eye. But if you have a telescope, you will be able to see it because telescope has higher sensitivity. So bigger the telescope, higher the sensitivity. So that's why the sensitivity and resolution can be increased if you make bigger and bigger telescopes. So that's why all the radio telescopes are very big in size. One of the earliest radio telescopes is Parkes radio telescopes. And you see the images, right? You see the images of radio telescopes?
Yes, it is seen.
Yeah. So there are single-disc radio telescopes, Parkes radio telescope, and its diameter is 64 meter. You see 64 meter. It's not a very small one. It's a very big one. And then top right, you see a telescope called Arecibo telescope. And its diameter is 300 meters. You imagine 300 meters. 300 meters means it's much bigger than a football ground. And this telescope you see, this is not a this type of, but it is made inside a valley of a mountain. So there are mountains all around the telescope, and the telescope is built in between those mountains, and 300 meter. And it is one of the biggest single dish radio telescope. And then this recently China made China made even better telescope, that is 500 meters. So these are bigger and bigger telescope helps to have more better sensitivity and better resolution. And then in India, you also have, India is one of the, so the radio astronomy science is very rich in India. And we have very excellent telescopes in India. And it was actually pioneered by Professor Gobind Swarup. He was the pioneer of radio astronomy in India. Unfortunately, he died actually yesterday. And that's a very sad news for all of us, for all the radio astronomers in India. He was very old, but still he's one of the father figure in radio astronomy. And he first built radio telescopes in Kollam in Maharashtra in 1965. And then he built another radio telescope in 1917 in Udupi. And then GMRT, it is used to be one of the biggest radio telescopes in India, in the world. And it is near Pune, and it was built in 1990. And all these bigger telescopes actually is very useful for doing research. And then many famous discoveries have been made using these telescopes. And so these telescopes is not just a single telescope. You see there are many telescopes, like there are 30 such dish antennas, and they are all connected, and they act as a single telescope. So these telescopes are spread over a 25 kilometer by 25 kilometer plots. And you see the bottom picture, those small things are telescopes actually, and this small region is basically 25 kilometer by 25 kilometers. Imagine a telescope of the order of size of the order of 25 kilometer, and 25 kilometer because you need higher resolution and higher sensitivity. Right, so now, but this is not enough, because we want to observe even smaller objects, and we want to observe even fainter objects, because if you want to observe the early universe, the universe, the time when universe was created, that objects are very far from us, and those are very faint objects. And if you want to observe those kind of objects, we need to have even bigger telescopes. So now this next generation of telescope is being planned, and then the most ambitious radio telescope, it is called Square Kilometer Array, SKA. It will be the ultimate telescope, and it is built by many countries together. It is not possible for one country to build such a big telescope. So currently 20 countries joined and they are building this telescope, and the telescope will be built actually in Australia and South Africa, two different countries, and India is one of the member countries. So I said there's 20 countries. So India is one of the 20 countries actually joined this project. SKA, square kilometer array, because square kilometer means the collecting area will be one square kilometer. So let's keep those things. And then, so why do we want to build such a huge telescope? So there are many unknown questions that we want to know answer of those. For example, we know the Einstein theory of relativity as a very successful theory, and it explains whatever observations we have so far, it can explain. However, those observations that proves that Einstein general theory of relativity is right have been conducted at weak field limit. We don't know whether those theory will be valid if the gravitational field is strong. So SKA will be able to tell us whether Einstein theory of relativity is very correct when the gravitational field is very strong. Another question is what is dark energy and dark matter? So I already said the dark matter. So it is a matter that is invisible. We don't see it, but it is there, and it is five times the visible matter. And it is not only dark matter. There is also dark energy, and dark energy is even larger. So currently, the 70% of the total energy of the universe is made of dark energy, and 25% is made of dark matter. So 75 and 70, so it is 95% is basically dark, either dark energy or dark matter. So you see, we don't know 95% of the universe material. Only 5% that is visible matter, that is made of stars, gases, and those things are 5%. So SK will be able to tell us what is dark energy and dark matter. Not completely, but it will give us enormous information about those things. And then another important questions that we all worry about is the life, searching for life and planets. So whether we are alone, whether only Earth has life, human like living beings, or there are other planets also have living beings, we don't know yet. And SK will be able to give some hints on that, like it will be able to find a material that can support life, like organic molecules. And also SK will be able to find planets that is habitable. That means the temperature and atmosphere is something that is suitable for having living beings. And another important question is whether to know the history of our universe, like how universe started and how it has become the way we see it. So we know that universe started with a Big Bang, that we all believe, but what happened after that and how universe evolved? And particularly one important question that we all we don't know is that when the stars first time formed in the universe. So there are no stars when universe during the Big Bang, and no black holes. So when did they form? We don't know. So SK will be able to tell the answer. And then, so I think these are the main important questions that SK will be able to tell. And since this is a collaborative project, India is one of the member countries. So this is an important opportunity for all of us to get involved with this kind of activity. So if you want to know more about those projects, and if you are interested, you can, so there are websites for SKA, and also there is SK India Consortium. You can Google it and know more about it. That. So I think I have almost done with my presentation. I want to finish my talk with by showing you a movie. And it summarizes that it summarizes what SK can do for us. So I shall show you the movie and then stop. Just wait for a minute. Can you see the movie? Hello?
Yeah.
Can you see the movie? Yeah. Can you also listen to the sound of the movie? Hello?
Hello. Yes? Yes, yeah. It is visible. Okay.
Can you see the sound?
Sound is not coming.
Oh.
Sound is not coming.
Okay. So then. Okay, so now I finished my talk, and if you have any question, you can ask me.
Okay, thanks Dr. Dutta for your nice presentation. Now I request the participant to ask questions by typing in the chat box. Due to limited time, few of your questions will be answered. Please type some questions. Okay, so we so have.
There are already some questions, right?
Okay. So Nitanga Das has asked, hydrogen atom spectra lies in visible and UV radiation. So to detect the existence of hydrogen, we need to detect radiation due to ortho and para hydrogen transition. Is it that radiation which the radio telescope detects?
Hello. Okay. So, hello. I think the radiation that radio telescope detects is hyperfine transition. So basically, it's atomic hydrogen, ortho hydrogen, and then so this ground state of neutral hydrogen, it splits into two energy states, and that is because of the interaction between electron spin and proton spin. And this splitting of the ground state level, that gives you a transition corresponding to the radiation, and we detect that radiation. Okay, so next question is at the
Rahul Das.
Yeah, so at the
Rahul Das, sir, at the beginning you had shared a periodic graph coming from the center of our galaxy. Why the graph is periodic?
Okay, so that is because the Carl Jansky, actually he was rotating the telescope. So as I showed you, this telescope it can rotate. It was put on a circular orbit. So while it is rotating, when it was towards the galactic center, it can detect the signal. When it is out, away from the galactic center, it cannot detect anything because signal is not coming from other part. Only it is coming only from the center. And that's why, so this telescope was rotating 360 degree every 20 minutes. So if you see the graph, every 20 minutes there is a peak. That means every 20 minutes it is pointed towards the center one time, and you see the peak there. And if it, when it is away from that, you do not see anything. That's why it is periodic. Did I answer your question?
There is one question from Kustav Panda. He asked you that, is the blue and red shift are due to Doppler effect?
Yes. So when the galaxy is going away from us or observer, the light is red shifted, and when the galaxy is coming towards us or observer, the light is blue shifted. So it's basically Doppler shift. And from that, you can actually measure the velocity of that galaxy. Because we know the velocity and red shift relation, right? So we can actually measure the velocity of the galaxy using that observation.
So let us thank the speaker if we have no question. Thank you, sir, for your outstanding presentation. Through your wonderful lecture, we have really enlightened that how radio telescope and radio astronomy can be used to explore the universe. We have learned a lot of new wonders like pulsars, neutron stars, dark matter, dark energy, etc. about the universe through your wonderful lecture. Thank you, sir. I hope you will always be available with us as and when.
Thank you
once again. Thank you.
Thank you all, and thank you for joining me.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Now, I would like to introduce our third speaker, Dr. Sumit Chaudhary from Queen Mary University, London, UK. His broad area of research includes astrophysics and cosmology. Dr. Chaudhary has obtained the postgraduate degree from Jadavpur University and did his PhD from Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur in 2016. Then he moved to National Center for Radio Astrophysics for his first postdoctoral work before joining the second postdoctoral research at Astronomy Unit of Queen Mary University of London, UK. In spite of all this academic achievement, it is very much excitement for me to introduce my brother Sumit for my locality before the audience. Now I request Dr. Sumit Chaudhary to deliver his lecture. The title of his talk is The Evolution History of Universe. Dr. Chaudhary, please, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Tatanda, for a nice introduction. Also, thank you, organizer, for giving me this opportunity. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. So good afternoon. So today I am going to present. Let me share the screen. Yes. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, it is visible.
Sumit,
it is visible.
Okay, fine. So today I'm going to talk about the evolution history of the universe. And you have already heard about the quark, that is the building block of that universe or any matter, you know. And also you heard the talk about the seeing the universe, how using the radio telescope, there are different telescope at different frequency band, radio, optical, UV, gamma, all these things. And these are the how you can see the universe. Now in this talk I will mainly focus on the how the universe evolved as a function of time, how it was at the before, how it evolves, and finally it comes to today, what we can see the today is our solar system and the galaxies, all these things. Let me start with this quote by famous astronomer Carl Sagan. We are made of star stuff. So the meaning is that the atoms and the molecules, so basically the calcium in your teeth and the nitrogen in your DNA, all these things are made up from the star stuff. So the all those atoms or the molecules were formed at the stellar core, and there is explosion, it come to the space, and finally it's combined and we are made of these star stuff. So basically the cosmos is within us. We are part of that cosmos. Let me question again, ask another question. What is this universe? We are trying to see, trying to know the universe, and what is this? In short answer is that it is sum of all total of all existence that we know, that space, time, and then matter, energy, all these things, what we can think of is all the part of the universe. So universe is a broad picture, and what we see, what we think are all of us part of that. So this is our total universe. Total universe. How the universe look like? So we are trying to go one by one and step, and we will finally reach our evolution. It's evolved. So start with this. We know this is the Earth, and this is some dimension. So before going to the Earth, we know our locality. It is a few kilometer distance. And now we know the Earth. This is 2,000 kilometers, and light will take some few millisecond time to reach from one point to another. Now, if we zoom out a bit, this is the solar system. We are part of that solar system. Sun is our at the middle, and all the planets are revolving, and it has some parsec distance. The distance is few more, and they take some second to come from sun to us to reach us the light. So if you say as a terms of the light, how much it takes from the start point to end point, you can see that you can visualize what the distance is. From the Earth, it is millisecond. For the solar system, it's few seconds. Next, if we go to beyond solar system, there are some neighborhood of this solar system. There are some other stars that are part of us. Next, if we zoom out a bit, this is the Milky Way galaxy, and we are part of that. So if you see the red point here, this is the solar system. So this Earth, all the planets, and all are is within one pixel with this large Milky Way galaxy. Next, yes. Next, we zoom a bit. This is the local galactic group, means Andromeda is not an isolated one. It is part of the another galaxy group. And you can see the Andromeda galaxy here. So, and we know that Andromeda galaxy is coming towards us. So basically, these all are combined with a larger group that is called local galactic group. Next, we zoom a bit. This is the Virgo supercluster, and this all the galaxies, the group of galaxies is part of that. Next, again zoom out, this is the total universe we can imagine. So even the Earth and the solar system is not in one pixel of this image. So you can think how big the universe is that. We are a small, tiny part of this total universe. It is a total, it's a huge, what you can imagine. Now, question is, how much do we know actually about our universe? So this is all we can think, that you have some observation in the real local universe, that the galaxies and the planets, all you can see. But the observable universe that I showed in that large image, do we know actually that all these things that I discussed? The answer is we know only a few part of that. So what we know and what we can see, let me discuss. This is the night sky, you can see, and all the stars and galaxies are blinking, and we can see that different group of the stars and galaxies, and you can see the light. So this is, you can see from your naked eye that stars are blinking. And the best thing of the night sky is that the light takes some time to reach from the source to our naked eye. And we are seeing not the present state of the stars, not the present state, but the state which are few times ago when the source emit that light and it reach now. So that this is the night sky picture, and it is not the present. Depending on the distance of the each stars, we can see different state of the different star. So this is the, we can see that this is the light can be used as a timeline, as a time travel time. So basically the time travel, we can go if we see the light from far back, we can probe the universe at the later stage. If we see the light from the present state, we can observe the universe at the present stage. So light is the important tool to study the universe at different states, because it takes some time, and when it comes, it's now. We are not seeing at the present state, but at the stage when it was emitted. So this is the great opportunity or great thing about the light. Next is that our observable universe. So because light takes some time to come, we are not able to probe the universe what it exists, because universe, we know that universe formed at 14 billion years ago. So at that time, what light was emitted, that will reach us today. So we can see only this part within this volume. If there are some material or some stars and galaxies beyond this black circle, we can't see, because the light will not reach us today due to the universe age. So only light which emit at 14.8 billion ago will reach today, and we can probe only this much. Beyond that, beyond the black circle, we are not able to probe, because we are using light as a tool, and light takes some time to come. That is the main thing. But now question is, what do we really observe, what we can? So in the earlier picture, I have shown that all the material, all the universe within this black circle, we can probe using light. But do we observe, do we have already observed using the light what we can? Answer is no. We have observed only a small part of the observable universe. So if you see the outer circle, that is the CMBR, cosmic microwave background radiation, that is some initial stage, not the 14.8 billion years, but after some time, that we have observed using telescope. And the next is the center of this circle. There are some local universe using telescope we have observed. So it's still the red part, the most of the observable universe is really unknown to us, and we don't know what happened, but there are some theoretical predictions that it comes from the earlier stage, that CMBR, to the present state, but still it is not experimentally verified. Next is that I will zoom what we have observed in the outer circle and the inner circle. In outer circle that I called is the CMBR, cosmic microwave background radiation, and this is a tiny fluctuation of the radiation, because universe is made of matter, radiation, all this part, and this is called as cosmic microwave background radiation, and this is time fluctuation, and the universe age was 10 to the power 5 years at that time, and what we have seen today, that is the outer circle that I have shown in the earlier slide. Next, I will zoom in the inner part of the circle, that is the local universe. And you can see these are the galaxy groups. And in the center of this, we can tell this is our position. And in the semicircle is that we have observed in the using the radio telescope. So these two parts
experimentally observed and verified, but still much of these things are really unknown to us. Now, this as a cosmologist and as the whole cosmology community are trying to observe using different sensitive telescope, different tools, trying to probe the universe that we have not observed, but we can using the sensitive telescope. So the cosmologist aims, cosmology, the aim is to fill this whole gap, the black part, and see the universe, how it evolves. So if we see experimentally using telescopes that this was the earlier stage and this is the final stage, and if we map at each and every point in this circle, we can see the how the universe evolved. So basically, this is a movie. It starts at some point, it evolves with some different complication, and finally at the end stage. So this, if we can probe, we will see the movie by our own eye. But it is really unknown, but we can. So this is the total evolution. This is the final and end stage is observed, but we have not observed experimentally, but we have some physical knowledge. We have some knowledge that how it evolves. So I will tell that how the physics and how the history of the universe evolved from then to present. Let me start with that initial stage. So it is called the Big Bang, when this is the time it starts from here. And the universe was made up of hot. So after the Big Bang, the universe was very hot. And it was the matter and particles all are like a soup, and these are colliding each other, and it is a plasma thing, and these are radiation, matter, particle are all combined, and this is a hot, dense plasma that you can say. That is the early stage of the universe. And then what happened? At the time goes on, the universe cooled down and the atom formed, the electron and the proton combined to form the basic atom, that is the called neutral hydrogen. When the atom formed, the proton, that atom, the matter and particle was the combined at the initial stage, but when the matter combined to form atom, the radiation decoupled, the CMBR decoupled. So that we are calling as a CMBR, cosmic microwave background radiation. We are seeing that radiation that emitted at that time today that I have shown in the CMBR. So that is the stage after the universe cooled down and the atom formed and the radiation decoupled. That was the stage called the recombination stage. And CMBR we are seeing and we have observed using the telescope like Planck, WMAP, and this is experimentally proved, very experimentally verified. But the before that it was not, and also after that it was not, some part of that. Let me go to the next point. What is this? This is called the Dark Ages. What happened at that time? Now the atoms combine due to the gravitation, the atoms and all the matter particle combine to each other and forms large matter. So mass, all the mass are combined, lumped together. And this high density region, the stars and galaxies form using some nucleosynthesis process, some physical process. The stars and galaxies form, and the stars then again, so this is called the cosmic dawn, because the stars are just formed and they start radiating. This is called the cosmic dawn. Next, what happened? The radiation. So when the stars and galaxies form, they start to emit the light again from this star, because we know that sun is emitting the radiation. So they are emitting at different frequency band, and stars and galaxies start ionizing that universe again. So we know that before CMBR, before recombination, the universe was totally ionized. There was no atom. The hydrogen, sorry, the electron and proton are
not combined together. Again, the light from this, so again, if you want to reionize, you need some energy, you need some light. So basically, in the cosmic dawn stage, the stars and galaxies again trying to reionize the medium, and finally this is called the reionization process. So they start reionizing the universe again, and finally it reionizes the universe again. This is called the post reionization universe. Means the universe is again, the today what we are seeing is the reionization, post reionization universe, and the only the dense region where the density of the proton and new electron are much higher, there the recombination rate is much higher than the reionization. So at that place, or only that pocket, the neutral hydrogen is there, but in all other as a universe, all the other places, the universe is totally reionized. So this is the total history of the universe. Let me summarize this again, because this is the total topic I'm going to talk. Universe was the, as a start from a big bang, this was the initial how the time starts. Next, at some time, the universe was the hot dense plasma, and all the matter particle and the electron photon are combined. Next, what happened? The universe cools down and the electron and proton combine. This is called the recombination stage. And at that time, the radiation decoupled from the matter that we are seeing as a CMBR, cosmic microwave background radiation. Then from the dense region, the stars and galaxies start to form. This is called the cosmic dawn. Then they start emitting the light, so they again reionize the medium, and finally what we see as the post reionization universe. But we know only the few parts of that, basically the CMBR and the post reionization, some local galaxies, but most of these things are totally theoretical. There is no experimental evidence of the observable universe. So now question is how to observe that, because if we see the optical light, after some time the optical light we can't see. Using our telescope, this will become too faint and we can't see after few distance. So 21 centimeter line is one of the tools. In the next I will talk how to observe, how the scientists trying to observe this total evolution history of the universe. So this is one of the tools that is called the 21 centimeter. At the hyperfine transition, when the hydrogen atom from the ground state, they are too hyperfine state, and when from the higher state to lower state, it hydrogen atom goes and it emits a line that is called 1420 megahertz or 21 centimeter. So this is one of the tools can be used to study the evolution history of the universe for the whole stage, because the hydrogen is the most abundant component of the universe. Hydrogen is everywhere from the initial stage to, because this is the simplest atom and it's everywhere. So the transition probability is more, and you can probe using this hydrogen or the 21 centimeter the whole history of the universe. So that is one of the tools people are using to study the universe. Let me tell you how the 21 centimeter can be used to study the evolution of the universe. This blue point is the emitter. Suppose this is one hydrogen atom and it is emitting a 21 centimeter line, and we are observer here. So because of the universe is expanding, the wavelength will increase. So the 21 centimeter was at the rest frame of the emitter, but not at me, or not at the observer point. So as the universe expands, the 21 centimeter will stretch. So finally it comes here. When it comes here, it is not 21 centimeter, but some factor. Suppose it is 23 or 24, might like that. So this is the tool. So suppose we set our telescope to set the to observe the frequency at 23 centimeter, we will probe the emitter. We will probe only this part of the this part of this universe, that is the blue dot. Now suppose there are another emitter, another hydrogen atom, which is far away, not at that position which I discussed earlier. So this emitter is quite far away. So now this will not be 23, but suppose this will be 25. So now we can set the telescope at 25 centimeters and we can probe at the different distance. So that is the 21 centimeter line at different frequency band or different wavelength. We can probe at different stage of the universe. And it will be stretched like this factor. That is, Z is the location or the redshift of this emitter. And it will be stretched, or the it will stretch by this factor. So different frequency band will probe different stage or different part of the universe and can be used. So if we set the frequency at different band, we can probe universe at different stage. So we can tune our receiver or the telescope receiver to observe 21 centimeter signal from different distance, then we can probe different states. So in principle, we can see, but now the total, so this is difficult to set the telescope to see the all the frequency band at one go, because this is difficult. Each setup, you have to set different telescope receiver frequency, different setup. So we can't see that all the stage, all the movie at one go, because it is difficult. It is, the stretch factor is different and the telescope configuration or telescope setup is totally different. So current generation telescope that we are trying is this part only, the yellow part, that is called the epoch of reionization, that I call the cosmic dawn. And after the epoch of reionization, when the universe start emitting the radiation and become the post total reionization, that is the post reionization. But only this part now people are trying to probe, because there are a lot of physics. So why this? Because there are a lot of physics involved this evolution process of the universe, how the stars form within the stellar core, and how the galaxies form, how they combine, and how they are emitting the radiation, how it becomes again reionized. So there are a lot of complicated physics involved in this process. So people, the different parts of the astronomy group or the cosmology group, are trying to probe the universe at this stage, that is called the epoch of 21 centimeter radiation. But theoretically, we can go everywhere. So this is one of the movie that is evolved. That is, so in computer, in your simulation or in your theory, you can evolve the universe from any time to any time. So that is one of the theoretical understanding or theoretical. Play this movie. Yeah, this is the movie that how the universe evolved as a function of time. Yes, so you can see that universe is totally neutral hydrogen, means it was no stars, no galaxy was there, and the universe was full of neutral hydrogen. Now at that, if at certain stage or the cosmic dawn, the stars and galaxies are start to form, and they're trying to reionize the surrounding medium, and it becomes enlarged. So there are more stars and more galaxies, and finally it reionizes all the medium from the radiation. So the different reionization pocket are overlapped with each other, and finally it reionizes the complete IGM, complete universe. So that is the total evolution history of the universe that we are trying to probe. But for the current generation telescopes are concentrated only few part, but in the simulation you can see how the universe evolved. So this is a small part of the universe, a three-dimensional box that you can see. Earlier, it was a full of neutral hydrogen. There was no electron and proton.
Then at the high density region, stars and galaxies form. They start reionizing the medium. And then finally, it completes the reionization process and the universe becomes totally neutral. So next, I will go to the what the people are trying to, how the people are building the different telescopes to probe the evolution of the history. And one advantage is that for the 21 centimeter line, it is in the radio spectrum, and 21 centimeter is the important tool. It emits from the neutral hydrogen at 1.4 gigahertz, and this is the radio spectrum. And the advantage is that it can pass through the atmosphere, so no need to go to the space, because so only optical and radio band are transparent. The atmosphere is transparent only in these two bands, but for the other band it is opaque. So if you want to observe the universe at the gamma ray or X-ray, you need to go to the space beyond the atmosphere, otherwise you will not be able to detect the gamma ray X-ray. But from the radio, no need to go space. You can do the observation from the Earth surface. That is one of the advantages, because space is more costly. And these are the future and radio telescopes that people are using to observe the universe. This is one of the telescope that is called Giant Microwave Radio Telescope. Kananda has already explained, near the Khordad, and this is one of the most sensitive telescope in the world at the low radio frequency. And people are watching all over the globe. They are using this GMRT to probe the universe at different stages. This is another radio telescope. This is not a disc type. So basically, the people are building different telescope to make it cost effective. So this is not a disc. So this is most costlier. Now this is like a tiles. You can see the tiles here. This is the LOFA, low frequency array at the Netherlands. And these tiles can receive the signal from the 21 centimeter signal from the neutral hydrogen. And you can use this telescope. This is another telescope, Murchison Wallenfeld array at Australia. This is also a tiles. This is a dipole-like shape, and it can absorb the radiation from the space. This is a dipole, and there are different dipoles are distributed in the Australia, basically in the desert. And all the telescopes are building at the quite far away from the locality. Because of that, the radio, you know, the FM band is the most FM band on the radio or the TV signal are affecting the observation, because we don't want the signal from the Earth, because the radio signal FM band, they are the man-made signal. They are emitting from the Earth surface and they are coming to us. These are the man-made signal, but we don't want. So if we set the telescope at the locality, it will not detect the signal from the space, because it don't know from where it comes. Whatever the signal it is coming, it will detect. So what we will get at the end of the day, suppose like FM signal. So that we don't want. So that's why all the telescopes are building quite far from the locality, because this is all in the desert. This is another sensitive telescope called Hydrogen Epoch of Reionization Array, HERA. This is also in Karoo Desert. This is called South Africa. And this is a huge telescope and most sensitive. I am part of that. So basically, they are building the more number of antennas. If we increase the number of antennas, your telescope will be more sensitive to detect the faint signal. So these are the telescopes are trying to detect the 21 centimeter signal. Using that 21 centimeter signal, we can probe the evolution history of the universe. These are the future telescope as Square Kilometer Array and OFA in India. They are also trying to detect the 21 centimeter signal. So till now, I have explained that 21 centimeter is a tool. It is a good thing. You can use the 21 centimeter signal as a probe to study the universe. So that we have built the telescope at different parts of the globe to see the 21 centimeter signal. We're building the telescope at the desert to avoid the man-made signal, but not the extraterrestrial, not the other signal. These signals are instrumentally inherent, because you can't build an instrument which is noiseless.
So 21 centimeter signal is very faint. At some point, it is more, the noise is more than that. So you have to build a telescope which is more sensitive. So these are the challenges you have to keep in your mind before building the telescope. Otherwise, you will get at the end of the noise and the man-made signal. So these are the challenges people now are facing. Another problem is the foreground, because this signal we are trying to probe from the cosmology, not from our galaxy. But our galaxy, this is quite nearby. So suppose the galaxy that is the Milky Way is our local universe, and the emitter, the signal emission is much more than the cosmological 610, which is far away from the observer point at the, suppose that the cosmic dawn where the stars and galaxies form. These signals are too faint as compared to the foregrounds, because the galactic synchrotron emission, this is nearby, and these are the challenges now people are facing. And so this is the one of the frontier research area. People are involved. We are also working as an Indian group to detect the 21 centimeter signal. But these are the challenges we are facing, and we have to overcome these challenges. So there are different approach people are using. Suppose the instrument noise, how it can be lower, how to remove the galactic signal from the telescope, from our Milky Way galaxy. These are the challenges we are working. And finally, at some point of time in future, we will be able to detect the 21 centimeter signal from the cosmology, not from our local thing, but from the cosmology. We'll be able to detect, and we can probe the universe as a whole. So basically, this is an ongoing effort, ongoing research, and there are many more opportunity to involve in this. And you can do some research for the evolution history of the universe. So that is the main, that is the thing I wanted to say. The take-home message is that universe evolution history, the study of the universe is important because we want to know how it evolved, how we are curious how the universe formed and what we are today, how it formed. So that we are curious. So that's why the study of the universe is important. 21 centimeter signal, one of the tools that can be used. So 21 centimeters is radio astronomy is a growing field. People are working at different parts to detect the signal, and they are building more sensitive telescope, and also trying to develop the algorithm and to detect the 21 centimeter signal. But as a cosmologist and also all over the world, people are want to know how the universe evolved from the experimental, not the theory, but from the experiment. So I will end here, and I will take questions now.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Chaudhary, for your nice presentation. Now I request the participant to ask questions by typing in the chat box. So if there is no question, so I thank the speaker once again for his nice presentation. From your wonderful lecture, we have come to know the evolution history of the universe. From your lecture, it is learned that we are the sun of the stars. Through your wonderful lecture, we are really enlightened that how radio telescope and radio astronomy can be used to explore the unveiled universe. We have discussed the total evolution. You have discussed the total evolution history starting from Big Bang to present universe. We also learned a lot about the universe through your excellent presentation. Thank you, sir. I hope you will always be available with us as and when we organize such type of seminar. Thank you. Thank you once again. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you. Yes, sure.
Now I request Professor Shobhan Kumar Mahato, faculty member of our department, to convey the vote of thanks. Professor Mahato, please.
Yes. Yes. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Hello.
Kindly deliver your vote of thanks.
Hello. Thank you, Professor Totan Ghosh, for giving me the opportunity to convey the vote of thanks. I am Sapun Kumar Mahato, faculty member in the Department of Physics of this college. Good afternoon to all. On behalf of organizing committee, I extend my heartfelt thanks to everyone concerned in the webinar. At first, I am honored to offer my sincere thanks to Dr. Romana Ghosh, our beloved and dynamic principal of Balrampur College, for her utmost support to organize this webinar. I also express my sincere thanks to our president, Sri Shantiram Mahato, honorable minister, Ossimanchal Unnayan Parishad, government of West Bengal, and president, GB of our college, for holding out his wholehearted support to organize the program. I also extend my sincere thanks to Professor Sulitha Goswami, IQSC coordinator madam, for her advice and guidance. Thereafter, I extend my thankfulness and gratitude to our speakers, Dr. Kanand Kumar Dutta, Dr. Shashwati Ghosh, and Dr. Sumit Chaudhary, for their wonderful lectures. All three speakers have enlightened the topic and enriched us. We have really enjoyed the lectures. I thank the speakers once again. Next, I thank all the teachers and staff of our college for their active cooperation. My sincere thanks to Professor Jayant Maji and Professor Kajal Maji, Department of Physics, UV College Assumption, for their guidance to make the webinar a successful event. Last but not least, I thank all the participants, eminent teachers, research scholars, and beloved students who participated and made our effort successful. I hope and expect the near future find the fog of uncertainty will be removed and a new sun of hope will appear in the horizon. The situation will improve and we will be free from pandemic. We shall try to organize seminar on open platform. We shall be able to exchange our thoughts and emotions in a social mood and well known area. Once again, I thank you everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Mahato. With due permission of our principal madam, I officially announce the session is closed here. Thank you all. Please submit your feedback for getting certificate. It will be available today up to 9 p.m. So please fill up your certificate. The certificate link is given over the chat box. It will also given on the WhatsApp group. So please fill up the certificate for getting certificate. Thank you.